The theme for this video is the goddess cannot afford me. The goddess can't afford me. That is the mantra of the day. The goddess can't afford me. And so we will explain that. Sometimes the best thing you can do is just to show up. Just to show up and just give it an effort. Now, clarity rests upon clarity, which rests upon clarity, which rests upon clarity. So sometimes you get a vast constellation of clarity, which is what happened this morning for me, and how to put that all into a, you know, easily digestible format is a question. But just showing up is very important. The goddess can't afford me. What is the goddess? A psychic projection. It's all a projection. And the goddess is our own projection, but we'll talk about it, you know, in a term as if it's represents something. It represents our belief in a separate will. It represents our belief in a separate will. Now, but we don't have a separate will. It's very important to realize this, that we projected our will and then disassociated from the projection to make it seem like it was a separate will. And this, we believe this separate will is trying to buy out God, trying to buy out God. And the goddess is our negotiator with God, actually. Now, the goddess claims she's a business partner with God. A business partner. They're in business together. No, she's trying to buy God out. Okay, she's our representative. Let's put it that way. The goddess is our representative based on our desire to have a separate will from God. And she's there to buy out God. Okay. See, but the goddess can't afford me. Goddess can't afford to buy out God. Can't afford to buy out me, because my will is one. Our will is one. Our will is not split. It's indivisible. It's the will of God. There's only one will, and it's the will of God. The goddess cannot afford me. Okay, this is your protection. This turns the tables on the world. Because the goddess is trying to get all of us to generate enough ransom, income, oh, I say ransom, income, to purchase, buy out God. And God will now be a wholly owned subsidiary of the goddess, is what the plan is. So she's busy at that. Now, that's easy enough to understand, that the goddess, we think she's a business partner. We say, oh wow, you're a business partner of God. You're working together. Oh, okay, great. Let me support your efforts. But we're really supporting her effort to buy God out, so that that our separate will is now greater than God. That was our goal, to be greater than God. Have a greater will than God. But how does that translate down into our lives? That's the big question, but it most certainly does. And most seeing that is, you know, all important. This is all theoretical. By the way, the ego analyzes and the spirit accepts. Okay, this is very true. So what we need to accept is that the goddess can't afford us. She can't afford us. She keeps saying she can. She goes, oh no, I can afford you, I can afford you. And, well, you know what she can afford? Is an image of us. An image of us. Okay, that's what she can afford. So all those that she says she's already purchased, really she's purchased an image that we've, you know, an image. And so we're living as an image. We're living as an image. Most everyone in the world are living as images. So evidence that the goddess can't afford to buy us. And she says, look, I've bought all of these people here, you know, God, so I can certainly afford you. Now she just bought an image of us for a little while. But an image is not what we are. And she demands that when we appear in this world, that we appear as images. Okay, we appear as images, not as our true self, which she can't afford. She can't afford it. She doesn't have any real money at all. It just has paper money, image money, an image of money, an image of wealth. And so those who are, you know, pursuing this objective, which is why everybody's here, they're only living as images of themselves. Because the goddess cannot afford to purchase what we really are. She says, don't let any of you. So, Now, those who want to actually don't want to be images, want to appear here as their true self, the world doesn't want that, the goddess doesn't want that. And so, how to translate this down even further is the question. So let's just see. We need to get an acceptance, a general acceptance of the situation before you can really, you know, look further. There'll be a little disconnect here when I try to bring something else in, but you just have to kind of have sort of a general acceptance of the general premise of what we're talking about. The goddess cannot afford us. Now, for example, the goddess, those who really want to bring enlightenment to the world and free us, the goddess says, "Oh, I can afford you. Oh, sure, come on in. I can afford you. I can afford you. No problem. I'm working with God, making deals. So, I'll help you out. I'll help you out a lot if you just help me, because I'm working with God to get your release. You know, well, she's trying to get our release from God." She says, "Oh, you want a release from imagery? Well, I'm working on that with God." No, she's working on it, trying to make it purchase your spirit, purchase your soul. She can only purchase an image. She can't afford to purchase our soul. God made us unaffordable, right? Where God created us totally unaffordable. Nobody can purchase us. Nobody can purchase us. So when you come here to work on trying to bring this facts here, bring the truth here, the goddess says, "Sure, I'll help you. You know, if you help me, I'll help you. We're in business here. You know, we're a team. God and I, you know, we're a team. Yeah, two wills. See, we're working to unite the two wills. Sure." But what happens is she can't afford you. What happens is she has other higher priorities. So, like for me, she says, "Oh, I'm going to help you out. Don't worry. Promise. Sure. Easy on promises. Easy. You know, oh, you want to help bring enlightenment to this. Okay. Yeah, we'll support all that. I got unlimited money." But what happens is she has tons of other higher priorities. In fact, I'm the lowest priority. So all the attention and money goes elsewhere. You know? And you end up a pauper, is what it is. Because you're just like the lowest priority possible. But of course, you'll never admit that you're not a priority. She said, "Oh, of course you're a priority. I'll get right to you. But that's the last thing she wants to do. She you know, sees no value or success there, because she's in the back of her mind, she's saying, "I don't think I can afford him yet." Which is really saying, "I can't afford you yet. You have to wait. I can't afford to give you anything yet because you're a little too expensive right now." So she won't tell you that, but that's what's the meta message actually. Still working on getting enough money. So she says, "Come on, give me more effort, more money. Boost my image. So that the image can be so great that God will say, "Oh, okay. Yeah, I guess you can buy me out." You know, so boost the image of a goddess. Boost the image of a goddess is what the world is engaged in. These are just ways of looking at the situation. Just, you say, "Well, how does it all fit together?" Well, it does fit together, but that seeing it as a totality in a moment of clarity is different than giving an explanation of it. So you have to be patient with yourself. Goddess cannot afford us, cannot afford to purchase us. Never, 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 never. We can't be bought. We cannot be bought. No one can afford us. We're unaffordable. God created us totally unaffordable. So get that. You know, just get what you can. Get what you can out of this. And I'm trying to pull through some. I had, you know, much greater clarity this morning, but then the day gets going. And you know, I'm doing this, and this. And it's like, you know, back to delusionville. this is a huge, 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 huge turnaround. Massive turnaround. A game changer. Thinking outside the box entirely. That suddenly I realized, oh my gosh, I'm waiting around for the goddess to have enough, you know, money to buy me out. Can't buy me out. Or having been made a pauper, for instance, I need the money to get back to reality. I need the wealth, you know. She doesn't have enough wealth to give me so that I can go back to what I'm accustomed to, which is go from an image to reality, to the real, you see. So having thought that you're having experienced yourself as an image for so long, having been, you know, pressured into this image situation in this world, how do you go from an image to what you really are? You know, you don't think you have the wealth to do that. How do you go from a pauper to a prince? Can the goddess give you enough wealth for that? The answer is no, she can't. But of course she keeps insisting she can, because that's our will. That we have a split will. It's our will, but we can't split it, but we can have an imagination, we can. And so she represents the split will, and we want that split will to be able to buy out God. So we don't want to admit that we don't have the money, don't have the wealth to re-equip ourselves for reality, to remind ourselves of reality. We don't have that wealth. That's why we have to call upon our true treasure. We have to call upon our one true treasure to do the job. The goddess can't do the job for us. All she can do is give us images. Now she can give us images of gurus and saints and beautiful sunsets and waterfalls and, you know, and all this other stuff, and mansions and things. But those are just images. All she can do is give us images. She cannot give us the living waters, the living water. Dead water. It's all dead. What she gives us is beautiful pictures of death, really. But how beautiful is that? Does that remind us of our true wealth, our true treasure? No, it doesn't. She can't afford. So here I am waiting, 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 waiting. She says, no, I can do that. I can do everything. I know how to do that. But okay, that's our own projection coming back to us, that we think we can buy out God. We have as much wealth as God, that kind of thing. So it's not an image that can remind us of our true wealth. It's not an image. It's not an image of ourselves that can do it. At least of me, an image of me, an image of you, can't do it. Now, because we are so addicted to images, I don't mean just photographs. All perception is just imagery. Projection is imagery. Perception is imagery. We're not perceiving what is. So, what's the remedy? Can there be an image that reminds us of reality? Because the continuity problem is we're afraid to go from images to reality. We're afraid to drop all imagery for knowing reality. We don't want an image of reality. Doesn't suffice for us. Cannot afford our lifestyle, you see. I say the goddess can't afford me. That is true. She cannot afford me. She cannot afford you. She cannot afford anyone. Because our lifestyle is total glory. She can't afford it. She can't afford to keep us in a life that we're accustomed to, you know. We're beggars. We're paupers. As we wander in a daze about her kingdom here, in abject poverty, babbling like mentally deranged homeless persons, just struggling so bad. We're all like homeless people here, really steeped in extreme deprivation, And all the while she says, no, as soon as I buy out God, you'll have everything. As soon as I buy out God, you'll have everything. So that's all she ever says. I'm going to save all of you. She says, I'm going to save all of you. She's got this obsession. I'm going to save you. Don't worry. Just wait. I'll save all of you. She doesn't have anything to give us, really. But here's the problem. We're so used to images that we're afraid to drop all imagery altogether. So the way I understand it is the Holy Spirit has the final image for us. And somehow the Holy Spirit is able to make this image lovely enough that it reminds us of reality. And then we're no longer worried about dropping imagery. So the Holy Spirit knows that the will is not split. So somehow it's able to give us this image, which of this total image that is fresh. And the goddess cannot afford to do that. Her images always are decaying because they represent split will. Split will. They have to accommodate the split, you see. So all the images that you give are accommodating this belief in split will. Even though they're trying, even the idea of uniting wills still has the split will there. Whereas the Holy Spirit is able to give an image that does not have to account for a split will at all. So it's a better image. And it's still an image. It's still an image. But this image is like a polished mirror. The goddess's mirror is like a fogged up mirror. It's always fogging up. Whereas the Holy Spirit's mirror remains crystal and clear, always. And so this final image has this seamless quality to it. It has all these qualities to it that remind us of reality. Now, this can't purchase reality, but it can remind us of reality. See, the goddess is trying to purchase reality. And she's really saying to us, just wait until I can afford it. And I've almost got it. And you just have to give me a little more loyalty. You know, build my confidence up that I can do it. I'm just lacking a little confidence to pull this deal off. What else can she say? You know, the goddess is full of excuses. Full of promises, full of excuses. And meanwhile, we simply wait in death here. Simply waiting in death. That's all we're doing. We're just waiting in death here until the deal is completed, which will never be completed. There is no deal. There's no purchase deal, okay? The deal is a reminder deal. God has given us a deal. God gives us a deal, but through the Holy Spirit, not through the goddess. Through the Holy Spirit, God gives us a deal. And said, here, look at this image. And this image is a reflection of reality. And in order to do that, the mirror has to be flawless and not subject to decay or death. Whereas the mirror the goddess holds up to us is decaying and dying and disintegrating. It doesn't remind us of reality at all. It reinforces the belief that we're just an image. We're just an image. And of course, we're saying that an image is superior to what we truly are, to reality. The imagery is superior. And supposedly once we buy out God, that we'll realize this. We think that our unhappiness comes because God is trying to sabotage our unhappiness. Get God to calm down and accept it, you know, to seduce God and get God to say, oh, okay, you know, become lovers with God. The goddess and the god become lovers, and God will say, oh, okay, the image is what you are. I now see it's better, it's greater than I am, and I accept it. And then the goddess says, no, everything will be perfect, everything will be happy. That's the fairy tale, the dynamics that are going on in this world. So what we have to say is the goddess can't afford me, only the Holy Spirit can afford me. Only the Holy Spirit has the money to purchase me. You know, goddess can't purchase me, she doesn't have sufficient money. And it's just a statement of truth, it's not a statement of arrogance. It's a statement of arrogance to say the goddess can't afford us. Because we're really saying that we're greater than God when we say that. What we're saying is we can purchase ourselves away from God through our imagination, through imagery. That's what we're saying is that imagery is more satisfying than reality, than knowing. That's arrogance. That's arrogance. So we say, no, imagery is not more satisfying. Now, only the Holy Spirit has the vision of oneness, has this vision, this image, just one image. It's a way of perceiving everything is fresh, clear, is a superior, it's healed perception. It's spiritual perception. And that's, the Holy Spirit has the money to produce that image for us. The goddess doesn't have the money to produce that image, never will. Again, has to account for the belief in split will. That will has been split. Makes it impossible to provide us with an image that reminds us of reality. No matter how beautiful the imagery, nature imagery, music, all this stuff. No, it doesn't remind us of what we are. So the goddess cannot afford me. Cannot afford me. So this is just an intro into a more substantial level, a basic level of understanding. Which is necessary now because the imagery in the world, the because of high technology has been brought in here, all this stuff that's going on. The Pope is going to broadcast in 3D, I think, in April. Not a good thing for the world, okay? So the push is in my opinion, the Pope is working for the goddess, okay? Let's just put it that way. This Pope is working for the goddess. Broadcasting in 3D, and we're supposed to say, wow, you know, this 3D is where it's at. The goddess does have the money. Look at this. She can purchase us from God. She can. You know, we're succeeding. This is the success we're having. So all of this technology, the holograms, lasers, 3D, imagery, all this stuff is our continued attempt to support the goddess and her work in convincing God that She has the money to buy him out, purchase God, to purchase us from God, really, you could say that, to purchase us from God, so another way of putting it, and of course then God would not have anything anymore, and the world is saying that, look, what we have is better than reality, look, we got 3D, how can you beat 3D? So the Holy Spirit's being forgotten. See, people talk about the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, and oh, you know, but the Holy Spirit has something for us. It's got the real money for us. It's got the capacity to give us an image that we really want, which reminds us of reality, actually reflects reality. That's what the Holy Spirit really has for us. So we start with saying, Goddess, you can't afford me. You cannot afford me. Why am I not working for you? You can't afford me. So I say, Goddess says, why don't you work for me? You know, you can help me. I'm close with God too. No, we just imagine the Goddess is close to God because she's our negotiator that we have invented. And we think the Goddess is going to be able to seduce God, and God will agree to release us from reality and all this stuff, and be able to some way to purchase that. And she wants that we want to make this world really beautiful and then take pictures of it. Pictures. Why do you think the world is obsessed with pictures? Everyone has smartphones. Picture, you know, send it to my Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, this, right? Everybody. Oh, everywhere I go, oh, look at this, click, look at this, click, look at this, click, click. Everybody has their cameras with them now and ability to send it to all their friends like that. Why do you think that is what's going on in the world? Because it is. And then everyone has these television with all these channels and the wireless and tablets, they can stay connected wirelessly to their home TV. The whole world has been rigged for imagery. I mean, what could be more obvious? Living here in Silicon Valley, it's obvious, but it's all over the world. It's all over the world. Everybody's taking a selfie. They say, oh, I'm taking a selfie. Oh, gee. And then I'm sending my selfie to other people. Yeah. When does it click in place and say, wait a minute. This is what's going on. This is what's going on. It's not something else. This is what's going on here. This is the Goddess culture. And she wants to work. I want you to work to make everything beautiful. You know, plant more and more beauty flowers there, and then take pictures, take video pictures, and then share it, you know, share with everybody. And she says, you see, that's how you're going to be happy, is sharing imagery, sharing images. Now, I've been down that path. I know exactly what it's all about, very much so. Just, you can take beautiful imagery and share it with everyone, and that's the answer. You see, then you'll be happy. And God will see that you're happy, and that'll give me leverage I need to complete the deal. Because God keeps arguing, says, they're not happy with you. And if I can show, she says, if I just show that you're all happy, then God will say, oh, okay, all right, I'll sell. And, you know, this is not just talk, this is literally what has already happened in the world. And all the infrastructure is already there, and it's going to be more and more and more and more. I know when you work for the Goddess, which we all do, you know, and if you want to, you know, be high up, you say, I want to get close to God. And she says, oh, I'm real close to God. In fact, we're business partners. I said, oh, wow. She says, if you're close to me, you're close to God. Because I'm going to be the new God anyway. We're in process of transferring that, you know, to making a business deal. And so if you're then you're close to me, you'll be close to God. See? And so how about, really? How do I work for you? How do I, oh, go take all these videos, take all these pictures, beautiful nature, this, you know, post them and get everybody into beautiful imagery. And, oh, okay, really? Huh. She says, oh yeah, you'll be, you know, so successful with that, everybody will love it. And then, but no, it doesn't happen. Just, well, I'm busy doing other stuff. I gotta hook everybody up first, you know. There's always something else he has to do first, right? But what she's saying is, I just gotta complete this deal, and then you'll be happy. And the deal's never completed. Amazing. As very heavy stuff, because this actually relates to your life, relates to life. I can totally relate to it. She says, oh, I'll send you somewhere where there's all these flowers. Just take pictures of the flowers, they're beautiful place. Share them with everybody on the web. Share this, share everybody. Shares beautiful pictures of the world. And she says, and that'll make you happy. No, it's just imagery. The world cannot afford us. The world of imagery cannot afford us. Can't afford us. I mean, we got to finally admit that. It's like somebody wants to come and purchase our home. And we say, well, I mean, you want to purchase our home? Well, what do you mean? Can you afford it? I don't think you can afford it. And we say, oh, sure. Here are these pieces of paper. Here, I just click. I took an image of money. Click. I took an image of gold. And they say, here's my purchase. I'm purchasing it. I say, wait a minute. That's a photograph of gold. You know, where's the real gold? He goes, huh? This is better than real gold. She says, this is better than real gold. Let's just imagine you've got this incredible mansion, this beautiful, beautiful estate. And this lady comes up, says, hey, I want to buy your estate. Huh? I want to buy my estate. Who are you? Who are you to purchase my estate? She goes, what do you mean, who am I? I got the money to do it. I got the money to do it. I said, what? She says, yeah. I said, well, this estate is, you know, incredibly, possibly expensive. You can't afford it. She goes, sure I can. Here, look. And then she hauls out these photographs of gold or something, or actually a painting of gold. She has a painting of gold. She says, here, here's the gold. I say, well, yeah, it's a painting of gold. It's not the gold. She goes, no, I know it's not the gold, she says, but actually it's better than the gold. It's better than the gold. This is literally what's going on, and we've been duped by it. We think, it's better than the gold. Well, wow. Okay. She goes, yeah, I get the house. You get the painting. You got more than me. You made out so incredibly great on the deal. Way more value. And so we got this painting of gold, and she's got the house. Doesn't really have the house, actually. She can't afford to live in the house. Can't live in the house. But you understand what I'm talking about. That we made this sucker deal. Because we want to be greater than God. We wanted to believe there's something greater than God. So we had this lady, it's all a projection. We had this lady come to our house and would sell us on this painting. And so we thought we left our home. Could go dwell with her in this where we have pictures of, you know, picture of our home, picture of gold. Painting, lousy painting. And the problem is we're trying to protect them. We're spending all our energy trying to protect the paintings, you know, from disintegrating. She says, oh my God, it's disintegrating over the years. Got to coat it, you know, and protect it and keep the air from getting in and oxidizing it. And everything's oxidizing. The painting, you know, the painting's always oxidizing. She has tells us frantically to keep everything clean. Your treasure is deteriorating. And so we're freaked out. You know, we was like, oh my God, this treasure that's greater than my true home is disintegrating. What's happening? So we're terrified. And the goddess is frantically, you know, like a fire captain saying, you know, put out the fire here, put out the fire there, put out the fire there, put out the fire there. And those people who say, you know, I think the Holy Spirit has something better for me. And then she says, I got no time for you. I got to put out these fires. You're not putting out these fires for me. You know. She says, well, go put out the fire. Once you do that, your painting will, you know, you'll see how valuable it is. Who would sell their house if somebody just gives them a picture of gold? Just a picture of it. Because I got a lot more of that where it comes from. I can reproduce these pictures endlessly. I got millions of these pictures. Just put them in a copy machine. And Xerox, choo-choo-choo-choo-choo, you know? I got a whole book full of gold right here. Every page, look. Pictures of gold, every page. Here's the book. Now, is God buying that? No. Remember, our house... is all God's also living in our state. We live with God in our state. So God didn't leave the house. God didn't sell the house. We can't sell God's house. We think we did. We think we sold it to this lady, this goddess. But we didn't. And we said, hey, guys, how come you're not living in the house? She goes, I will very soon. We're going through escrow right now. We're going through escrow. I'm going through escrow with God, is what the goddess tells us. I say, okay, I'm tired of waiting, you know. I want to get back to my house, you know. She goes, yeah, I'm the new owner. I mean, every title, deed, everything, you know, you signed everything over to me, and it's, you know, it's all good, but it's just escrow. We have to go through these technicalities and stuff with God, you know, and God's got all these technicalities, she says. She blames it all on God. She says, God's, you know, just can't let go. God just can't let go. You know, the sales, real estate lady, you know, they got all these, the talk. Just can't seem to let go. You know, he's got some kind of retention thing going on, thingy. Yeah, he's got some kind of retention thingy going on. He's having problems letting go, separation anxiety. You know, he's got some issues. God has some issues. I'm helping him work through those issues, you know. As soon as we can work through those issues, then escrow will close, and yeah, you'll be able to move back into your home. I'll be the new owner, and you'll enjoy it way more than you did with God. But in the meantime, you've got this picture of which is even more valuable, actually. In fact, she tells us, why do you want to go back home? You know, I mean, this picture is way more valuable. You haven't understood the value yet of this picture, you see. But you will. But don't worry, I'm closing escrow too, so you can go back there whenever you want. But meanwhile, try to appreciate the greater value of this picture. That's where we're at here. And something inside us says, oh my God, you know, this we've just been scamming ourselves. But now let's go back and say, did God give us the authority to sell our estate? Sell his estate? God's estate? God give us that authority? Do we really have that authority? No. So our signature is worthless. Is the painting really worth anything? No, it's not worth anything. Did we really sell us? We didn't sell our house. Painting's not worth anything. And yet we have a continuity problem because, oh my gosh, I've been worshiping this painting for so long. I've been impoverished for so long. How can I possibly go back to my estate? I'm a bum. You know? I mean, even though we can understand all this talk, and we certainly can, I can understand it, clear as a bell, but we're still like a bum, but dressed in rags. And the bum says, how in the world can I go back to my father's estate like this, you know? We just feel ashamed, you know? We feel ashamed that we're so stupid, that we did this stupid thing, thinking we could sell our kingdom to some outside will. Again, the goddess is just a projection of this whole idea of a split will, that we're greater than God, that we could split the will of God and have us be greater than God. So we're just playing this prank on ourselves, really. We're just pranking ourselves, but we've pranked ourselves so badly, you know, that we're ashamed. And so we don't want to go back in this, you know, shame. So that's where the Holy Spirit comes in. It's the Holy Spirit says, here, look, put this robe on. Gives us some decent clothes, you know, to wear, so to speak. Spiritual clothing. Clothes us in spirit. We've just pranked ourselves, really. And again, Holy Spirit puts the, just look, I know you're ashamed to go back into your father's estate. And robe on, spiritual robe on. So you don't look too, you know, too bad here. So you feel, okay, I belong out there. I saw this homeless person a while ago, and he was just in tatters. It was just horrible. He was just, and how can someone like that, whose mind is just, you know, seems to be gone, their mind is all ugly, their clothes are ugly, they're in tatters, they're in pieces, they're just, you know, how can they, like, for, you know, walk into, you know, the swankest, exclusive, you know, place, country club place or something, and feel like they belong, you know, that they'd be ashamed, even though mentally that's, maybe they say, yeah, I do belong, but I just feel, you know, look at me, you know, well, you know, clean them up, put nice clothes on. This is just a metaphor, and just I'm using just as an example. Give them a shave, give them a haircut, clean them up, clean their fingernails up, cut their fingernails, toes, give them nice clothing, you know, and then they come in, they realize, hey, I belong, and then it's okay. But right now we're so impoverished. Sensory perception gives us such an incredible sense of impoverishment that we're ashamed. You know, we're really ashamed. And no matter what kind of beautiful imagery we get, and I've searched for the most beautiful imagery in the world and tried to make some, you know, and it's still total impoverishment, still in a total embarrassment, totally shameful. We don't have a clue. Doesn't work. Just rags. Threadbare rags falling apart. You know, rotting. Stuffing come out of the jacket. And this homeless person was just, you know, repulsive as far as just the way they look. My God. And I felt, you know, terrible for him. But we're all that way. And you know, some of us are so far, you know, gone that direction, so into the goddess that way that we're willing to go down with the ship for now. And just temporarily, the pride is too strong. They're, you know, pranking themselves. The prank is still very much, they think they can, you know, they're still enjoying the prank to some extent. So there's nothing you can do directly at that situation. You have to just remain, you know, remain within the reminder of the Holy Spirit gives you. So what I did, I went inside the car and I locked the doors. I said, this is a little too strong for me to deal with, really, at this point. You know, you'd have to be a perfect teacher of God to deal with some of these situations in the world, but we're not, you know, quite there yet. See the vision of oneness, you realize the goddess can't afford that. She can't give you that. She can't afford it. Can't do it. Can't do it. Has to account for the supposed fracturing of will. At some point, the goddess will say that, you know, we've broken off negotiations with God, and God's refused, and so we don't need God. We're just going to go with all this imagery we have here in the world now that's sufficient for you. At some point, that's going to happen. I think it happened April 4th of 2014. I believe that there was this fundamental, okay, tough love time for the world, and this is what you have. This is what you got to get used to. this is what you have to settle for. And you're just basically stubborn, that you don't appreciate that images are more valuable than what you had before, and you need to now come to that conclusion. So there's this tough love of a goddess now, I believe, started April 4th, 2014. And that's why I call upon my treasure, my true treasure, my one true treasure. I said, hey, time to come in, because that's what happened. The goddess was just stalling until we got all this imagery, this technology of imagery set up in the world, so that then we could all feel like she could say, hey, you got enough here. This is the new kingdom. God just refuses to recognize it, but we don't need God. We don't need God. You got the goddess, you don't need God. And we'll just have to learn to appreciate the imagery. See, she says, the problem is you need to be educated. You're not properly educated at how valuable imagery is. She says, but once you become truly educated how valuable imagery is, then you will realize you don't need God. You don't need God. You've left God behind. You have something more valuable. And again, we're just pranking ourselves. We're just pranking ourselves. You know, like a teenager does something stupid, like they TP their own house, you know, just to pretend that somebody really cares enough about them to TP their own house. They get up in the morning and it's toilet paper everywhere. Oh my God, someone TP'd our house. But actually they did it, you know. We've just TP'd our own house, and we're claiming somebody else did it, you know. But we finally have to go to God and say, God, there never was any goddess, you know. It was all me. It was all me. I was just pranking myself, you know. I was just being kind of stupid, whimsical. Yeah, but we're so ashamed, you know. We're so ashamed of this that, like the prodigal son came home, and I think in the Bible it talks about this, and Jesus talks about this, and how God threw this huge party, you know, gave the prodigal son all these clothes and wonderful feast and everything. And his other son, who never left, said, hey, God, I've been here with you all this time. You never threw a party like that for me. And God says, look, this prodigal son has been wandering in, you know, pranking himself and wandering in just imagery of death and destruction and just horrible. And finally, he's come home. And he's so ashamed of himself, you know. And I've got to, you know, show him and dress him in finery and make him feel comfortable here again. That's why I'm doing it. And the other son got it, said, I understand. You know, okay, yeah. He says, I don't need to do that for you. You're comfortable here. You don't have any shame. This one has a lot of shame. So I've been telling everyone at some point, problems are gonna come here. And the problem is that this whole delaying tactic, we thought the goddess was in business with God, negotiating, preparing to close the deal. She's gonna suddenly say, you know what? God has just become unmanageable, unworkable, irrational, and I've had to drop the negotiations with God, and we're going to go on without God. And that's how it is. Because the whole problem, she says, is that you haven't learned how to appreciate imagery properly, and we're going to teach you how to appreciate that. She says, I got these great teachers who will enable you to appreciate imagery. And once you learn from them, you know, you won't need God. And she definitely trained me, the goddess trained me to do that kind of stuff. But I've been saying, no, wait a minute. I think this is a scam. So she claims she has these great teachers, but I'm not one of them. I'm not one of the goddess's teachers. Because all I was doing was to try to make an intermediate step, a soft landing to the Holy Spirit's one image of oneness, that does remind us of God, you see. But the goddess is saying, no, you can use this to educate people how they can be happy with imagery. And that imagery, see, we're telling ourselves imagery is more valuable than reality. More valuable, and all we need to do is be educated in this. Properly educated. So this is very heavy stuff, but we have to deal with this. But it's not too heavy to deal with because of this change now that's happened in the world. I said it was coming, and I believe it has come. Very interesting. And the royals of England, suddenly they're taking their baby, what, Prince George III or something, on a world tour, some tour. He's going 3 weeks or something out in public, you know, take turn. And it's very interesting that Eric Julian, who predicted April 4th when the ETs would make their presence felt or something in London, he actually said that was an attention getter to the royals. And he says the royals actually are the key to the situation, whatever it is, which is a symbol of the hierarchy, okay, of the goddess hierarchy. Asserting itself now in the world. There's some sort of situation. And so in some ways, he was on to something. He's on to something. There's no question that ever since that April 4th day, I've felt this enormous shift has taken place and required me to call upon my true treasure. So it's a necessity to get this information out. And of course, they don't want anyone here that shows that there's something better than an image, or that the Holy Spirit has a better image than, you know. No, they don't want that. They want everybody so distracted by taking pictures, sending pictures, they're not paying any attention to the Holy Spirit. It's a great time right now to turn to the Holy Spirit. A great time. And I hope this video has brought to light some issues here, brought to light. Even if it doesn't, you can't quite, you know, fit it all together necessarily. Definitely explanations. You have to be a genius to fit it all together. But maybe it'll, you know, sort of trigger something like, I think I sort of get it. Just a couple things. Remember, we're just pranking ourselves, really. Just playing a prank on ourselves. This whole thing is just a prank. A restless teenager pranking themselves, really. And we've sent this sales lady here, and she gave us a painting of our estate, and we signed over the deed to the estate for this painting, thinking the painting was more valuable. We've been worshiping this painting, but the painting's falling apart. And then she said, well, yeah, that too. That's actually even more valuable than the painting. That's another aspect. Let me bring this up. So as this painting is falling apart, we're saying, oh, my God, you know, what's going on with my painting? This is scaring me. I'm losing my value. I'm losing my treasure. My estate back home, I like it more. I like it better because it didn't fall apart like this. And the goddess says, what are you talking about? This is even more valuable than the painting. Not only do you have a painting that's more valuable, way more valuable than your estate, this image, way more valuable. The fact that it's falling apart and disintegrating, that gives it even more value. It's a relic. It's an antique. This is way more valuable now that it's crumbling into dust. You You say, really? I know, but I'm kind of scared about this. You know, this is my home, and it's crumbling into nothing. And she says, yeah, don't you just love it? It's like way more valuable. You're so blessed, you know. You just don't understand. You need more education. You need to be re-educated. You still don't get it. God always says you don't get it. You still don't get it. I said, wait a minute, I think I do get it. I think I'm pranking myself. I think I've just pranked myself. that is getting it. I'm playing a joke on myself, actually. I say, God, I'm playing a joke on myself. Can you please help me out? Because I feel so, I'm so ashamed, you know. I have a continuity issue. I feel like I can't go back. I've got this painting that's disintegrating, and I'm so attached to it, you know. Can you exchange this disintegrating painting for one that's not disintegrating? So at least I don't feel like such an idiot, you know. And then if I don't feel like such an idiot, I can go home and say, hey, God, look at this painting the Holy Spirit gave me. And God will say, ah, it's a nice painting. We'll hang it up in our mansion, you know, because it won't disintegrate. And that'll be a nice reminder of the prank that you played on yourselves. And I say, okay, deal. Got a deal, God. We've got to get to the point where we can laugh about the whole thing, because we're just pranking ourselves. And the more we can see that, and the more we can see that we just have a continuity issue here. We got this painting that we thought was more valuable, and now the painting is disintegrating, and we're being told, we're telling ourselves through this, you know, projection, this real estate lady, say, oh my God, you're so fortunate. Look at that. My God, your painting is an antique. It's historic. Yeah, that's a historic painting. My God, you're fortunate. We're saying, oh man, I mean, it's like the rain's coming through the roof, you know. I mean, the painting is falling apart. The colors are fading. It's all faded. You know, where's the gold going? It's all fading away. She goes, oh, that's awesome. That's totally awesome. You're blessed. You're totally blessed. You know, and we're saying, God, I don't know. You know, no, this is not right. It's a prank. Oh, I'm pranking myself. And it's like, I'm pranking myself. This is all a prank. Just pranking myself. That's all I'm doing. Played a really good joke on myself. Real prank. But now I got this continuity problem. Like, I'm too attached to the painting. I'm just going over. I'm too attached to this painting. Too attached to this. I'm so attached to this painting. Because I just don't want to throw it away. I just don't want to trash it. I just don't want to throw it in the dump. You know? I just can't do that. You know, I feel like I thought that this was my value for so long. I just have a hard time just throwing it away. And God says, don't worry. Just exchange it. God said, look, here's the painting of gold. But these colors don't fade. You know, this doesn't fade. And you say, oh, okay. I've still got an image. But now, oh my gosh. Because then you look at it carefully and you realize it's not fading. It's not fading. It'll never fade. You see it because you compare. You say, I say, I know, I can tell the difference. It's a living canvas. I mean, the canvas itself is vibrantly alive, you know, and it's not fading. You just say, wow, that's a way better image. It's still an image. You still got this picture. It's still an image. But now you say, you know what? I got an image that reminds me of value. This reminds me of value. And then you can go home and you feel like, God, I know what value is. And so I can appreciate my home now because He gave me this painting. Holy Spirit gave me this painting. It solves the continuity issue. It solves the continuity issue. So we have to laugh. We have to laugh. We have to chuckle at ourselves at this point. Otherwise, we are going to freak out. Because the goddess is saying, folks, it's now time when you have to get it that this disintegrating painting is truly your real treasure, and you have to learn how to treasure it, and we're going to now educate you how to do that, and it's time to get down to business, the goddess will tell you. And that's what's happening in the world. Time to get down to business. No more fooling around. God has broken off negotiations. You know, He's decided He doesn't even want you back, and He refuses to educate you about your, you know, the true value here. and you don't need. Yeah, he's a lunatic. He's insane. So we're finished with that, and we don't even need it anyway, because this is more valuable. This is the message that's going out. April 4 started that this is the message, and this is the message that I was freaking out. I've been, you know, freaking out for several days. Fortunately, I'm holding it together and able to laugh at myself, pranking myself. I have some humor, enough humor, hopefully, to get through this. I don't know. It alternate between humor and freak out. You know, it's like, wow. That, a lot of, like, sudden, like, body suddenly moves and some kind of breath comes out. Like that. Like, whoa. You know, it's the, what's leaving me is this seriousness about taking the goddess seriously, thinking that that's all the serious instead of now is coming in is that it was all a prank. I'm just pranking myself. You know, we're just pranking ourselves. That's all. The whole thing. Nothing made this all an elaborate prank on ourselves. So, those who are truly able to laugh at it are very valuable. Very valuable to help us laugh. The opposite is the freak out. You know, the opposite is the freak out. Or, you know, and the freak out gets turned into fanaticism to learn this lesson that we think we have to learn now. It's time. God has turned out to be a lunatic, we think. And God has told us cannot do business with God. We thought we could. She says, I thought I could at least purchase the house for you so you'd be kind of happy with it, you know, make you happy. But it turns out I can't purchase it because he's a lunatic. So, but it doesn't matter. What you got is way more valuable. You just have to learn how to appreciate it. You got this addiction to your old house, but the old value, but you said, but the new value here is way better, way better. You just have to learn to appreciate it. And that's where the world is going to become fanatical about that, fanatical. And of course, if you want to go back home, this freak out, you know, just like, I've just been shaking, my nerves just been shaking, like this, I said, wow. Very frightening time. And there's the issue about those who don't want to go on this learning program. The goddess wants to get rid of them. She says, well, all those people, they're relics, they want to hold on to God, and they're disrupting the learning environment, so we need to put them on in a special ed place, some desert island somewhere, you know. Need to put them on a desert island, special ed for those who are, you know, holding the rest of the class back. You know, they're what do you call it? In your class where there's a troublemaker and they're distracting the students and stuff, and the teacher says, hey, move them out of the classroom, put them in special ed, and put them on meds and stuff. So the guidance will say, okay, let's all you folks there, you can't quite get it yet, can't get with the program, we'll put you in special ed, put you on a desert island somewhere. Stick a couple palm trees there and call it good. Never to be heard from again. So there's that issue potential also, which is kind of a freak out too. But you have to expect it. You have to expect that. Heavy stuff. That's part of the prank too. So you get this humor, you can laugh at the whole situation, and you just say, Goddess, you can't afford me. You can't afford to buy my house. Sorry. You can't afford me. Gotta say that. Goddess, you can't afford me. Because that's the prank, right? We're saying that there's something that can afford to purchase reality from us. What could that be? What can afford to purchase everywhereness from everywhereness and say, hey, I got a place to stick everywhereness. Yeah, I'm going to purchase it. What is that? Something outside of everywhereness can purchase everywhereness? It's, you know, it's a prank. It's ridiculous. So you know, the goddess cannot afford us. We need to start there because that's the lady that's coming to buy our house, you know, our reality from us, we think. And we're sending, it's an image we're sending to us, imagery. And we gotta say, Goddess, you can't afford me. You can't afford my house. You can't afford to buy it. this is a potent, potent, potent mantra. Because she'll hold up that painting of gold and say, here it is, I got it. I say, no, you can't afford it. You can't afford it. You don't have the value to purchase it. You can't afford to buy me. See, goddess, you can't afford me. You can't afford me. And this deflates the whole prank. Deflates the whole prank. We're using our will. See, our will is no longer believing it's split. It's an expression of one will, unsplittable will, undivisible will. Saying, no, I know this is a prank. You can't afford me. You cannot afford to purchase me. Goddess, you can't afford me. Don't engage in any talk with her, negotiation. No, you can't afford me. That's the bottom line. Bottom line is you can't afford me. And then as you realize you can't be bought, the goddess fades away because she's only a projection of us pranking ourselves. Okay, goddess, you can't afford me. All right. Very great. That's it.